If you recall, we showed some bar graphs earlier in the class. These are the bar graphs right here. As you can see, they represent the current value of the pi tags. And if I scroll backward and forward, let me scroll backward and forward, you can see those bar graphs are going to go up and down. Now these bar graphs here, they're all actually multistates as well, which is a topic we'll discuss later on. Multistates will change color as the values change. And that can actually be something that's applied to things other than bar graphs as well. Just about any object other than trends can have a multistate. So let's look at how we would create this new bar graph. I'll just go ahead and create a brand new display, just a little workspace I can work in. I'm going to go ahead and click on here. This is my bar graph option. I could have also done this using, in build mode, using the data favorites. Remember, data favorites gives me the option to specify bar. Either way, well, in this case, we'll have a builder screen to build the bar graph. In the case of the data favorites, we just build it for you automatically. But let's go into the manual way. We'll get rid of data favorites. I'm going to go ahead and create a bar graph. And this bar graph appears asking me, well, some pertinent questions. First of all, what tag is involved? And for that, we can do a tag search. I think for my purposes, I'll just type in sinusoid. And then we're being asked to specify what the limits are and whether this is going to be horizontal or vertical. So the limits, the upper limit and lower limit, are typically going to default to this 0 plus the span. The lower limit would be the 0. And then the start value will be the 0. So typically what this looks like is, well, this is the maximum, which is not labeled here, but the maximum is actually 0 to 100 in the case of sinusoid. The minimum is down here, that's the 0, and then this is the current value. Now the current value, I can show you that current value by just taking, let's just hover over this. You can see the current value is, 59.783. So taking a look here, that's what the current value is. In some cases, people would like to see this at the same time. So we simply suggest you add a value object to that as well, which is something we'll discuss more later on. That would just add a value underneath. Now, let's go back into the builder screen by double-clicking on this in build mode. Let's see what happens if we change the start value to 50. What we're going to do at this point now is we're going to extend the value up and down from that 50. So let me give you an example. Let me show you what I mean by that. I'm going to go ahead and in run mode. Remember, I can do an ad hoc trend. I want a trend on here quickly so that I can scroll backward and forward. So I'm going to drop an ad hoc trend on here that quickly. And then I'll zoom in a little bit. And watch what happens now as I scroll back. As I scroll back, see the value, the end time, or the timestamp that we're using for this bar graph, it's always going to take the timestamp of the end time of the trend. And so as that value changes, you can see it's extending up and down from that start time value. So that's what we mean by the start value. Now hopefully it's obvious what we mean by max or upper and lower. Let me just go ahead and put this back to the 0. See, I could specify something else instead of the 0 plus the span. If I wanted to go 0 to 200, I could simply do it like that. Now my bar graph has got twice as much, that's twice as much max, which in the case of sinusoid means it never quite goes up to the top. So typically we default to the maximum, the 0 plus the span. Now, there are times when you would like to do this as an upside-down bar graph. It's fairly rare, to be honest, but you could want to do that. So if that were the case, you could specify the upper is the 0, the lower is the tag 0 plus the span, and then the start would be the tag 0, in which case now we have something that's going to extend up and down, in an inverse fashion. So we've made this flexible enough even to create things that you would probably think you'd never need, because our experience is that one way or another people tend to want these things, so we try to design them all in up front. Now the horizontal bar is going to change the orientation, but it's not going to change the shape. So as you can see, this is now oriented left and right. But if I really wanted to use this as a kind of a gauge, like this is my gas gauge type thing, I'd have to change that shape myself. There we go. And for that, it is significant whether you want to go left or right. So the start may end up being right here at the tag 0 plus the tag span. So now we're actually going, we're looking at this a little differently. And I can change the, left and right here. That would be the 0. This would be the 0 plus the span. I'd like to show you now what is probably the single most common difficulty people have with this. Let me go ahead and drop a few more bar graphs on here. I'm going to go back in, show the data favorites, and let's default to bars. And let's just drop a few more on here. Here's one. Here's another. Oh, and look at that. It's taking the, it's taking what we had. Let's see. Yeah, there we go. It's taking what I last set this as my my default. Let's go ahead and change that back. We're going to go with a 0 and a span that's traditional and a vertical. And let's see, let me delete these. I don't need these anymore. Let me drag these over. Yeah, there we go. So now we're looking at these the way we traditionally look at them. And let me show you probably the single most common mistake people tend to make. Most common mistake is not knowing what the color scheme we're using here is. And we've got a nice little slide that tries to explain it. Essentially, the fill color is going to be the color that indicates the value. So in the case of this, you know, traditional bar graph, that would be the fill color. Here's the fill color if it extends from the top to the bottom. And here's the fill color if it's going from, say, the middle to the top. Now, the background color is the color in the background behind the fill color. So whatever's not the fill count, a fill color ends up being the background color. And then finally we have the line color, which is this, what's surrounding this. These are all controlled through these color options that you see right here. Here's our background color. So for example, if I would like to make this a blue liquid filling a red vessel, that's how I would do it. Okay. I can change the fill color. Let's say it's now a dark green filling a red, it's going to look like that. Yeah, so that's probably the biggest confusion is what do we use for the background color. So here we change all these background colors. Let's go with a white background color, and we'll choose let's go with a dark red liquid there, or dark red indicator of value. Now one last thing I did want to point out is that, and let me close this out, is that in many cases people would like to see some kind of gauge over here or tick marks. We do not support tick marks by default, but you will be able to bring in from our symbol library tick marks that you can, that can be used for this purpose. So, for example, in our symbol library, let's open up that. I'm going to go ahead and draw this to go right adjacent to this bar graph here. And the category we're going to be looking for is called scales. So under scales, you'd find the variety of scales that might be useful for this. I'll go ahead and select this one. Go ahead and say OK. And now, you know, through positioning of this, you can go ahead and come up with a scale that's appropriate for this bar graph. There you go. And if you care to, you can use, you know, you can position this on the top. So it looks more like what you might be interested in a traditional or in something you might be used to from your control system.